mighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we to pray, and to give more than we either desire or deserve. Pour upon us the abundance of your mercy, giving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those good things for which we are not worthy to ask, except through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Every time we celebrate confirmation, we say together the baptismal covenant, reminding ourselves, as the Apostle Paul says, that we are living members of the body of Christ, and that each member is equally valued and equally needed, and that we are called into this body for a purpose beyond ourselves, and that is to participate in God's mission to restore all people to communion with God and each other. And we do that when we proclaim and embody the good news of God's love for all people as revealed in Jesus. Now today's gospel: therefore what God has joined together, let no one separate. In today's readings, we are pointed to union, connectedness, community. The writer of the letter to the Hebrews tells us that we have one Father, that we are brothers and sisters sharing flesh and blood. In Mark's gospel, Jesus refers us to the scriptures, saying, "But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. The two shall become one flesh." Drawing from the story in Genesis when the Lord says, "It is not good for the man to be alone. So God made a partner, bone of my bones, and flesh of my flesh." From the beginning, humanity shares flesh and blood. From the beginning, we are created, connected. From the beginning, we are created in the divine image of the Holy Trinity, three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in community, in communion, union, at one, in the beginning. And that's the reality, that the theological term would be the metaphysic. That is the reality out of which Jesus operates when some Pharisees approach him and ask, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" Now, in the first place, it seems that we need to get some things out of the way before we look at Jesus' response to the Pharisees. And the first thing we need to get out of the way is that we don't pick these passages. I didn't choose this one. You're supposed to laugh at that. We don't pick these passages. And we need to look at the context of the question. Number one, this is not an innocent question, simply seeking information. It is a test. The Pharisees are trying to trap Jesus by using scripture and by framing the question in legal terms. As usual, Jesus is pretty slippery, and he quotes from a different passage of scripture right back at them, framing his answer in spiritual terms, not so much legal. And number two, the Mosaic law to which Jesus refers regarding divorce is intended to protect women who are seen by their culture as property to be discarded when convenient or necessary. Women have no rights, no protection, no way to support themselves. Jesus tells the Pharisees, "Because of your hardness of heart, Moses commanded that the man at least follow legal procedure and state the grounds for divorce." Moses' commandment was intended to give some protection to women. Not that women were allowed to make the same choice. Women were not allowed to initiate divorce. Women were seen as property. So the context of the question: is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? Is not the same context as it might be in 21st century North America. And Jesus' answer is not a doctrinaire prescription for all of life, forever and ever. Amen. His words, "Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate," is not a legal doctrinaire answer to a question framed in legal terms intended to trap. They ask, "Is divorce allowed?" It is not that far removed from the question, "Is divorce a sin? Is it always a sin? What is a sin? What is not a sin?" These are scorecard questions, as if someone is up in the sky keeping score. A superficial and on the surface understanding of sin sees sin as broken rules or violations of do's and don'ts, violations of things allowed or not allowed. An incomplete or partial understanding of sin locates sin in the category of behavior or thoughts or feelings of right or wrong, of fault or no fault, when the sin of the world is far deeper and broader than such a partial understanding as what is allowed or what is not allowed. Sin. And it is kind of odd, I feel, that a bishop is spending the morning talking about sin, but that's the text we get. Sin is our theological word for alienation, separation, dismemberment, exile, disconnection. The whole biblical drama is a story of alienation and reconciliation, a story of separation and union, a story of exile and communion, dismemberment and remembrance. Remember, do this in remembrance of me. Alienation is sin. So by definition, divorce is sin. I hope you're not shocked by that or think I'm getting preachy or judgmental, but having nothing to do with right or wrong or assigning fault or no fault, divorce by definition describes alienation and separation, at least most of the time. Maybe there are exceptions. So to clarify and not to compare, and believe me, I'm not comparing, maybe today the most visible outward sign of alienation is war. Again, it's not a question of right or wrong or who's at fault. Even World War II is sin, alienation. It's not a question of who is right or who is seen as evil or if the moral lines are drawn clearly or which side bombed the other one first. It is sin. It is one manifestation of alienation. It describes it. It defines it. Perhaps the good news of the gospel is that no one up in the sky is keeping score. But let's not deny sin by reducing it to fault or no fault or blame or broken rules. Sin is alienation, separation. Now, a few years ago, I heard a priest, formerly of Northwest Texas, tell a story about separation and union. Father Stuart Hoke, maybe some of you know Stuart. Father Stuart Hoke served on the staff at Trinity Church on Wall Street. And he was there on September the 11th, 2001. He tells quite a story about that day. When the second plane collided into the Trade Center, it became apparent that none of this was an accident, and that the damage was significant, and that the threat was real. And people began streaming into Trinity Church on Wall Street, streaming into the nave. So Stuart, at the suggestion of his rector, put on his vestments and took the organist with him and entered into the nave. All sorts and conditions of humankind are streaming into the nave. It is chaos. Stuart pulls out his prayer book and he prays the prayer for quiet confidence. And a calm begins to descend upon the crowd. And then the organist starts playing hymns and the people sing such hymns as, "O God, our help in ages past," And they read Psalms together, the 23rd Psalm and the 27th Psalm about fear. And then as he tells the story, Stuart says he recognizes within himself at that moment. At that point, he recognizes within himself a deep fear. Not so much a fear of death, as a fear that he will never see his family and friends again on this earth. His deepest fear is separation. So he reads to the crowd from the 8th chapter of Romans how nothing can separate us from the love of God, not even death. Stuart's greatest fear, and I suspect ours, is actually separation. Well, at 9:59 a.m., 1 minute before 10 in the morning, while Stuart is reading from the Sermon on the Mount, literally reading, "You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy, but I shall say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you." If you can imagine this, at that moment, suddenly the first tower collapsed. It was decided by somebody that it was time to get off of the island of Manhattan, so they are outside evacuating when the second tower collapses, and a dark cloud of dust moving, and I didn't know this until he told it, moving at 210 miles per hour, knocks them down and scatters them. And in the dark, they grabbed for each other, clumped together, Stuart says, clumped together like coagulation in the face of their primal fear of separation. Separation. What God has joined together, let no one separate. From the beginning, we are connected, sharing flesh and blood. One of the many lessons that Stuart shares about this experience is this. In the hours, days, and months after this horrifying act of terror, boundaries evaporated. Race, gender, class, denomination, religion, these boundaries evaporated. In the face of unbearable pain and unspeakable grief, humanity came together in a community focused on rescue and recovery, true, but also a community clinging to one another, in need of one another. It's a story of separation and union. What God has joined together, let no one separate. In this biblical drama of alienation and reconciliation, separation and union, exile and communion, sin and redemption, one deeply spiritual action restores us and reconciles us. One action initiates and opens for all of humankind, the possibility of communion, of atonement or at-one-ment, at one, in this Christian drama. Jesus of Nazareth is crucified on a cross. The incarnation itself, the incarnation of innocence, goodness, and divinity is executed. The outward visible sign of sin and alienation is this crucifixion of Christ. And Jesus forgives us. Jesus shows love, grace, mercy, and forgiveness. God even works through the most visible example of sin in human history, a crucifixion. And if we remember the story, community is not ended. In fact, it begins. Our deepest desire, our truest reality, communion, begins as the resurrected body of Christ, us. And we are here today at St. Luke's Episcopal Church in Stephenville, Texas, living members of the resurrected body of Christ, participating in God's vision of holy communion, that we might proclaim and embody God's unconditional love and unmerited grace and undeserved forgiveness, that we might proclaim and embody what we have received. In the name of the Holy Trinity, one God in whom we live and move. Amen. and have our baby.